October 11, 2014. Travis Hamonic is on his way to work. It's the New York Islanders' home opener, and the Nassau Coliseum is sold out. At 24, Hamonic is widely considered one of the best young defensemen in hockey. Tonight, just as at every home game, there is a young fan in the stands, a guest of Hamonic's he's never met. He and Hamonic share a bond they wish they didn't.
Hockey for me was just always my escape. I wasn't much of a talker when I was younger. I didn't like to talk about my emotions. But I do for a greater cause now.
So this was all yours?
Yeah, all this whole area in the back here.
This could have been where you ended up.
Yeah, it very well could have.
Travis Hamonic grew up here in St. Malo, Manitoba, a small farming community on the Canadian Plains. Along with his mother and three older siblings, he would work the wheat fields with his father, Jerry.
Hi!
Hi, Daddy! Can I go for a ride with you?
Okay, farmer of the hour, how's everything going out here?
Just starting now.
It was pretty, like, idyllic farm kind of childhood. My dad would get up super early and come home late or come home for lunch really dirty.
But Travis's father always made time for his family.
Happy Father's Day to you! Yeah!
Wait, Travis is getting in there.
That's our little brother!
He's my superhero. He was someone that I felt more safe with in this world than anyone else can ever imagine.
Say hi to Mommy.
Hi.
What you doing?
Hey, Mom.
With Daddy? You love Daddy?
As he started to play a bit more sports, Jerry just bonded deeply with Travis. They connected really early, and that connection stayed strong, really strong.
That connection was forged on the ice, and especially in the St. Malo rink.
So, what else? What do you got on your feet there? Let's see.
I got brand new skates.
When did you guys realize that Travis had a certain aptitude for the game?
He must have been about 5 years old. I was going to the rink he was playing with the 8 and 9 year olds, and I heard, "Go, Travis!" The crowd is screaming, and I see this little kid weaving up with the puck.
My dad loved taking him to the rink in the morning, and so I think there's that special bond between them around this great game.
I just think he really loved watching his son do whatever I was going to do, whether it was hockey or being on the farm. I just think he really was proud of me.
September 15th, 2000. Travis is 10 years old. His father is bringing in the wheat harvest.
It was a normal night. He came home, and he had been combining. We were all together, and kids went to bed.
Good night.
I remember waking up to my sister, Melissa, yelling at me, basically, to get up and trying to tell me what was going on. And I remember rushing out of my room, and at that point, my dad was getting stretchered out. Yeah. He's getting stretchered out, and the last thing he did was, he couldn't talk at that point. He just held out his hand, and I remember just grabbing it as they wheeled him away. That was it. It's the last memory I have.
Travis's father had suffered a massive heart attack. He died at the hospital that night. He was 44.
You're 10 years old, you're still trying to comprehend what's going on, what's not going on. Is this real? Is this not real? I mean, you're in shock.
Just days after his father's death, Travis and his mother went driving through their wheat fields, confronting the reality of life without him.
Me and Jesse went through that field last time we were on the farm with Dad. Yeah. Our wheat's not all done.
No, you're right.
Life stopped as we knew it. Devastation.
With their father gone, Travis and his brother Jesse would bring in the harvest for one last time.
Good job, Travis. That's Dad's boy. And he's gonna pray for us. I want you guys to remember that.
The following year, Travis's mother sold the farm. In 2003, when he was 13, Travis and his mother moved to Winnipeg, where she would work as a nurse. It was there that Travis emerged as one of the most promising young players in the region.
I really didn't talk much about my dad's death. I didn't open up to anyone about it. I was able to really just get away from the world and shut everyone out. But he's with me every day.
Absolutely crushed by Travis Hamonic.
When he was 17, the New York Islanders selected Hamonic in the second round of the NHL draft. Then, on November 24th, 2010, when he was playing for the Islanders farm team in Connecticut.
I looked at my phone and I saw 6 calls come in, and I knew something had happened. And I called him. And he says, "Mom, they called me up." Dad would be so proud. So proud of this.
Your son is like nailing it on his dream, like he did it. I just can't imagine how that moment would have been for my dad.
You know, I don't even know if words can describe.
Defenseman number 3, Travis Hamonic.
It was an unbelievable defining moment in our family.
Hamonic made an immediate impact, never looking back, except in one way.
The last thing I do before any game is as I look up to the left corner of the rink, ask God to let my dad be watching. I would trade in every game that I've ever played and ever will play in the NHL just for one shift of him being able to watch me play and for me to be able to talk to him after the game about it.
And so 3 years ago, Hamonic approached the Islanders with an idea.
I wish I would have had any sort of guidance at some point in my life of how to deal with it. I really had to start, you know, reevaluating what was going on and how I was handling my grief. I felt being humble and quiet about it was the best way for me to get by and the best way to not think about it. But it just caused me to think about it more and more. I couldn't block it out any longer.
After every Islanders home game, win or lose, Hamonic meets with children who, like him, have lost a parent.
It's a lot of sharing. It's a lot of opening up to a lot of people you don't know. It's a sense where you can kind of help each other out.
Kevin, what's going on, buddy? Nice to meet you.
Nice.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
You can call me Travis. Mr. Hamonic was my dad.
Okay.
You want me to sign that for you?
Yeah.
You have fun tonight?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you're a good luck charm. You guys want to come check out the room?
Yeah.
Yeah, go for a little tour. Come on.
Do you play any sports? This is our room here.
Oh, it's still.
I don't know if you know my story. I'm sure you guys are aware or not. When I was 10 years old, my dad passed away of a heart attack. I'm not going to lecture you guys at all in grief, and everyone has their own way of dealing with it. The biggest thing that I'll say from dealing with it, it's normal, whatever you're going to go through.
It's a really wonderful thing you do for the kids. I just want to thank you.
Unfortunately, we're part of a club. I meet all sorts of kids coming through. I realize that you're not in it alone.
A score for you.
And I like seeing hockey games in real life. It's a very rare experience for me.
11-year-old Jerry Horning never knew his father, who died from a brain aneurysm in 2002, when Jerry's mother was pregnant.
I was surprised because I lost my dad too. Meeting Travis, that was my favorite part. It was like meeting like a brother.
If I hadn't had outside help from Travis, I don't know. I probably wouldn't be here.
Like Travis, Thomas Callahan was 10 when he lost his father, 5 years ago, to a stroke.
I was thinking for the worst. I really just had no idea what I was going to do. And I felt like my world was coming to an end.
It was hard for him to tell me he was in pain, and hard for him to tell me he needed some help. But he reached out to Travis.
A lot of these kids I see, some of them are lost, and some of them don't know which way to go. I see myself in a lot of them.
This is my email, and if you ever need to talk, you ever need to vent, you ever...
Try to let them know that the sun will come out the next day, and it will get better.
For years, Hamonic kept his grief locked away, bottled up. Now, by giving voice to it, he's given hope to others. And he's given himself a chance, at last, to heal.
They always think that I'm helping them, but they really are helping me. Every time I talk, it gives me a little bit more closure and a little bit more satisfaction personally that I am getting through it.